Andy, nice to see you.
You too.
Almost a month into your new role as CEO of Swim England. Take a breath. How have you found it?
It's been a whirlwind. I was very clear when I started, it would be a really rapid learning curve. So I'm taking the time to try and meet as many people as I can, learn about what they do, how they do things. And of course, it's not been an uneventful first couple of weeks with the publishing of the listening report, which I'm sure we'll talk about shortly.
That getting to know people must be quite difficult when a lot of people work remotely.
It is, but you know, thank goodness for Teams and for Zoom. But I'm really, really keen, not just in terms of internal, you know, employees here at Swim England, but to go out and meet people in the community. So that's very much a focus for me over the coming weeks, to get out there, learn about the different aquatic sports, and meet as many people as I can.
So tell us a little bit about your career today. What's led you to the door of Swim England?
Yeah, I consider myself very, very lucky. I did a maths degree many, many years ago and hated it, and thankfully moved and changed to a sports degree. And I think that was a real seminal moment for me. Started a career in sport. So I've worked in golf for many, many years. That was my sport as a player growing up. Done a little bit of work around snow sports and triathlon before coming here to Swim England.
It's quite a broad spectrum, isn't it?
Yeah, I do genuinely think of myself as being very, very lucky. I've had some really broad experiences, all sorts of different challenges in different settings. You know, I've worked for UK organisations, Scottish, English organisations. So, yeah, I've been very lucky to see sport from its many different perspectives. And hopefully I could bring some of that to good effect here at Swim England.
So why this role now? Why the role of CEO of Swim England? What appealed to you about the job?
Yeah, lots of people have asked me that question over the last 6 months, and I think the brief was really clear that the brief was about change, that there are some challenges, and again, we'll come on to the listening report shortly, but there are some challenges facing aquatics in England, and I'm quite a change-orientated kind of person. I relish change. I enjoy the challenge that comes with bringing about change. And of course, it's the biggest participation sport in England. And that is very, very motivating for me. And I also find it really intriguing, the scale of the operation here. Yes, first and foremost, we're a governing body, but also we have some really crucial services that we provide to the aquatics industry. And that was very attractive to me as well.
This might be a difficult one for you to answer, talking about yourself, but what are the qualities that you think you bring to the role?
Yeah, as I say, I'm very much change orientated. Change isn't for everybody, and I respect and understand that, but I do enjoy change. As I said, the brief was very, very clear about the need for change here in the organisation. So there was a good match there. I think historically, when I was younger in my career, I was very, very logical. You know, I was strong in sort of maths and physics at school. I was very logical, very structured, and I still have that to a large extent, but I've really evolved my leadership style to be very much about clarity of purpose and about culture. You know, culture famously, you know, Peter Drucker said, culture eats strategy for breakfast. And I really subscribe to that way of thinking. And I think we've got a real opportunity to take a good hard look at the culture here within Swim England, first of all, and how does that then relate to the culture out in aquatics clubs and communities. So that's really appealing to me. And I hope that I can bring some of my past experiences and some of the skills I've developed over many years to good effect.
As you mentioned, you've made a career in sport, clearly a keen sports person as well. Were you a member of the aquatic community before you joined Swim England?
No, and perhaps a wry smile, because you know, I learnt to swim front crawl when I was 40, when I first discovered this thing called triathlon. I thought, well, I kind of need to swim front crawl. So I literally started from scratch. I couldn't swim a length of front crawl. I still can't do a tumble turn. I've given up trying, and I can't do butterfly. So I'm by no means from the aquatics community. But bringing that more to a serious point, I see that very much as an asset. You know, I've got lots of experience in the sporting sector, and I'm very much of an open mind and learning about the aquatics. But I have no preconceived ideas. I know very few people in the aquatics industry. And I think given where we are in the current time, that should be an asset for us.
You mentioned earlier in the interview that the golf was your sport. I think you competed at quite a high level, didn't you?
Reasonably high level. The dream was always to, you know, to go on tour and make my fortune, but I sadly was not anywhere near good enough. But yeah, I managed to play for Wales at sort of junior and schools level. And that was a huge honour for me growing up in North Wales. I don't play golf anymore. I very much enjoy swimming, biking, and running, hence the, you know, the link to triathlon of old. Probably surfing is my favorite thing. I just love the connection with open water and the environment. And when the weather conditions allow in this country, which isn't necessarily every weekend, there's nothing nicer than getting out on the board and trying to catch a few waves.
Andy, as you know, it's a challenging time for aquatic sports. Earlier this month, we published our listening report, which is part of our Heart of Aquatics plan. What did you make of the report as a relative newcomer to this community?
Yeah. Obviously, coming into the role, I was aware of the Heart of Aquatics plan and the listening phase of that plan. So it wasn't as if the intent was of any surprise to me whatsoever. But of course, actually reading the report when it did land was difficult. It was difficult for me after, you know, just a number of days in the role. So I can only imagine how difficult it would be for colleagues who work here at Swim England, for people involved in the aquatics communities up and down the country, you know, at clubs, coaches, volunteers, officials. It must have been a really difficult read for everybody. But it's important, I think, if people listening to this piece haven't read it, I would really encourage them to read it, because I think it's really important, and I think anybody that cares about aquatics in this country should really read that report.
Was there anything in there that surprised you in particular?
Surprise is a difficult word to, I think, to quantify in this context. There were things in there that I found shocking, that I found incredibly disappointing. But because I don't know the aquatics industry, it was difficult to say whether or not those things were surprising. But what I think is very clear is the report is if ever there was a clear call for change, then the report is exactly that. And my first thoughts are very much with anybody who's had a poor experience, and in particular those people who've survived inappropriate behaviour. There is no place for inappropriate behaviour in aquatics, full stop. I really acknowledge and I really apologise to those people for the poor experience they've had. Secondly, I also recognise up and down the country there are many, many volunteers and professionals who work day in, day out to make aquatics the best sport it can possibly be. And I want to recognise that. But as we've said, there can be no place in our sports for inappropriate behaviour.
So we've listened. What happens next?
So we've apologised, and I apologise again now for all those poor experiences that the report calls out. What we mustn't do is create some sort of knee-jerk reaction. We mustn't sit on our hands and wait for too long, but what we have to do is consider how we respond to this report. We have to consider it, first of all, as Swim England. The report's very clear. We need to change, and my commitment is that we will change. Let me make that really, really clear. We need to model the right behaviours and challenge those behaviours that the report calls out. We then need to engage with people. We are not going to do, the response to this report is not going to be a case of us doing to the aquatics industry. It's going to be a case of us doing with the aquatics industry and with the communities up and down the country. So I envisage us really engaging with people and taking people on a journey and addressing the culture. I think it absolutely has to start with culture. Yes, for sure, there will be clear actions. There are recommendations which we accept in the report. We need to take a really considered view on how we react to those recommendations. But as I say, for me, it absolutely starts with culture. And I ask for people listening to this, for your indulgence, please join us on this journey, join us on this commitment to change. When the opportunity arises, please engage with us on how we can change and address all of the things that we all find so unpalatable in that report.
That change, though, isn't going to happen quickly, is it?
No, but it starts right here and now. It starts today. It starts with me. I take my responsibility very, very seriously for me to model the right behaviours when I'm walking around the corridors here in Loughborough, whether I'm out and about meeting staff regionally, when I'm meeting with communities out and about, which I very much hope to do over the coming days and weeks and months. It all starts with step-by-step changes in modelling the right behaviours, in taking full account of everything that's in the report, and making sure that we don't accept those issues any longer.
It's been a tough time, but it's an opportunity as well. It's a chance to reset. Is that how you view it?
Yeah, my mindset really, I think, can be summarised in two ways. Number one, we must not be defensive here at Swim England, and I would encourage others to not be defensive either. But it has to be seen as an opportunity to change for the better, so that our sports are really inclusive, accessible, and most importantly, are safe for everybody and anybody that takes part in our sports.